Hello, I'm Kirsty Young. Thank you for downloading this podcast of Desert Island Discs from BBC Radio 4. For rights reasons, the music choices are shorter than in the radio broadcast. For more information about the programme, please visit bbc.co.uk/radio4. My castaway this week is the comedian and actor Rob Brydon. A decade ago, he was enjoying a lucrative but unfulfilling career as a voiceover artist, his ringing tones espousing the charms of pot noodle, toilet duck and tango, among many, many other products. But after what he admits was a rather wiggly road, it was first Marion and Geoff and then Gavin and Stacey that made him a household name. It seems his speciality in a cynical age, bringing to life characters without guile or cunning, eternal optimists who think the best of everyone around them. It may just be an act, of course, and I don't know how near the truth we'll get today. I usually don't give a whole lot away in interviews, he says. I could go into all sorts of things, but I don't want the drama. I avoid it. For someone who wants to avoid drama, then, Rob Brydon, I am astonished to learn that the birth of your last child started with you playing golf with Ronnie Corbett. In the end of the day, you were catching Tom in your arms in
that's
the sitting
true.
Room.
Yeah, that's true. See, he came 9 days early. It was my wife's first child, my fourth, right. And I assumed the first child, he'd be late. So I was very, very relaxed, you know, thinking, well, there's no way he's going to be early. So I'd arranged this day and off I went and Ronnie and I were on the golf course and Claire phoned up and she said, she's very sweet, she said, have you finished? And I said, well, more or less, yeah. And she said, oh, I think it's happening. Ronnie said, he said, all right, we better get you home. So this is all true. Got into the golf buggy and he sped across the fairways and I ran into my car wearing my golf shoes and drove home through the rush hour. It took ages to get home. And every time I'd phone, you know, Claire would be going, yeah, on the phone. It was pretty hairy. And got back to the house when the midwife came to the house, examined her, and she was too far gone. So it was decided that we'd have a home birth, and within about 3 or 4 hours, he was born. And that was when he decided, I think, that he wouldn't sleep for the next 18 months.
The whole Ronnie Corbett golf buggy traffic jam thing, I mean, it sounds like a 1970s sitcom waiting to happen.
Thank you very much.
you've said there that you do talk about it on stage, and indeed yeah. You use it for as part of this routine that is much appreciated by the audience. What about Claire? How does she feel about you?
She doesn't mind. She's cool about it. You know, I mean, she used to work in TV, so she knows the sacrifices that have to be made. You know,
you weren't tempted to call him Ronnie?
No.
And is Tom after Tom Jones?
No. See, I'm a big fan of Tom Jones, and got to work with him with the Comic Relief single, and I think he's very aware that I'm a big fan, you know. And I remember when I sort of told him that we'd called Tom, I may have detected a slight flicker of, oh, God.
That much of a fan.
Yeah, this is a bit worrying.
Now, tell us about the track we're starting with today.
Well, this is a song by Jack Johnson, and this reminds me of a time I spent in Australia shooting a show called Supernova. So this brings back so many happy memories of Sydney. It's a lovely, warm song. We had it at our wedding, and it makes me smile. With only two, just me and you, not so many things we got to do, or places we got to be. We'll sit beneath the mango tree now. Yeah, it's always better when we're together. We're somewhere in between together. Well, it's always better when we're together. Yeah, it's always better when we're together.
Jack Johnson and Better Together. I didn't really even acknowledge that astonishing Ronnie Corbett impersonation that you just slipped in there. You are very, very good at Ronnie Corbett. Of course, voices, that's part of what you do as a comedian, yeah, when you're up on stage.
Yes.
Find it easy?
Yes, thank God. I only do ones that sort of come naturally or who I like. And Ronnie Corbett, you know, is it's a wonderful voice. When I was in the West End doing my live show last year, he and Anne, his wife, came, and I do a little bit where I'm impersonating him. And as I was doing it, he got up from his seat and walked down the aisle to the stage. And I thought, you know, oh dear, what's he going to do now? And he took off his glasses and gave them to me. And the audience went bananas. And I carried on doing it wearing Ron's glasses.
How fabulous. And does he give you, I mean, do people give you tips? You know, Tom Jones also, you've mentioned, you did the single, went to number one, in fact, the single with Tom Jones. Yeah. Do they ever say to you, I don't think you've quite got it right?
No. Tom is very gracious about it. I mean, I don't know what he says when I'm not there. Oh, he's bloody doing it again, wasn't he? Oh, it's infuriating. But to my face, he's very nice about it. I remember him saying when we were in Las Vegas doing the video, he's going, oh, well, he's, you know, he's got the cough. Huh, he's got that down, you know. And I like discovering those. I do like finding a little key into someone's voice. You know.
What about the key to characters then? It's Uncle Bryn from Barry Island that you are best known for. Gavin and Stacey, three series of that, hugely well received. What was the key to Uncle Bryn? Because he is this sort of innocent who, in spite of all indications to the contrary, retains a great enthusiasm for life.
I'd love to, you know, siphon off as much of the credit as I can, but really...
Now's your chance.
All right, here we go. It was in the script.
And it was written for you?
Yes.
The part was written for you.
Well, with me in mind, yes. So Ruth Jones is one of my oldest friends. We were at school together, did school musicals together. I've known her since I was about 15. I don't have a sister, you know, but she's, I suppose, the closest I have in terms of familiarity and stuff, you know. James Corden I've known for about 8 or 9 years. What I like about Bryn and what I tried to bring out of him in the second and third series was this kind of irritable side to him and how he reacts under stress, which is something I've always been interested in. When we did Human Remains, there was a character in that. His name was Les. He said, I do react badly to stress, you know, when the walls are closing in, you know, and it seems there's no answer, that is when I will crack. Which I thought, dare I say, I thought was hilarious because I love people saying, you know, when the walls are closing in, and that is when I'll be up my best. He said, no, that is when I will crack. And I like that. Now, with Bryn, he can get very anxious. I find that very enjoyable to play.
One of the surprises of Gavin and Stacey, and it was a bit of a backdoor hit, really, wasn't it?
Yes.
And it was its Welshness that was part of its surprise, because I mean, I can't think of another comedy series that really has shown you that Wales is funny.
It's a very strange thing, the sort of underrepresentation of Wales in the media. If we put Hugh Edwards to one side, and I think we should, there's something about Wales, we're like a bit of a mystery. And I used to jokingly say that Gavin and Stacey had presented a palatable version of Wales, which is not to say that it isn't accurate. I think it's strikingly accurate, in as much as Bryn is a hugely recognisable character to me. Nessa is so much a type of Welsh girl that I can identify with, as is Stacey, as is Gwen, as is Dave Coaches. So many of those characters ring true, but they'd not been seen before.
We're going to have some more music for now. Disc number two is?
Well, Elvis. Now, see, I like Elvis.
Can you do Elvis? I'm sorry, it's annoying, I know, but you have a particular skill.
Well, I do. I like to do a very old Elvis. I like to do a very medicated Elvis. So I kind of go, I just like that every dream, every dream has come true 100 times. I learned very early in life, without a song, the road would never end. Without a song, I'm a man ain't got a friend without a song. So I keep singing a song.
I'm so glad I asked. Anyway, why have you chosen this Elvis track in particular?
Well, normally I choose a 70s Elvis song, because that's really the period I like the most.
Yeah.
But I was worried that my choices had a slight air of oral Mogadon to them. So I thought instead I'd choose something with a bit more spirit to it, which I think on a desert island would be welcome.
Oh, so give you all you just want to treat me right. You like to ball every morning.
Elvis Presley and Lordy Miss Claudie. You sing.
Yes.
You sing on stage. You seem to enjoy.
I love it. Any opportunity.
Top of a hat.
Any weddings, my own included, I will sing.
What did you sing at your wedding?
Oh, Great Balls of Fire. And
it's not the most romantic song to sweep her off her feet with.
Well, no, but technically accurate, as she was soon to discover. Yeah, I sang that. Oh, I can't remember, but that certainly, yeah.
And so your early days were in Port Talbot, which
yes.
was a highly industrial part of Wales. What are your strongest memories from being a very little boy?
Well, we lived in Baglan, which is very green in its own way, although it had BP, which at that time is not there now, was Europe's biggest petrochemical plant, and it had the steelworks. But if you go inland, you got these fantastic mountains. And if you just go a little bit further along the coast, you're at the Gower, which is, you know, absolutely breathtaking.
And the performing started very early. I've got a list here. Guys and Dolls, Carousel, West Side Story, big musical numbers at school. Did you play the lead in all of them?
I think you'll find I did, Kirsty, yes.
To great critical acclaim?
Oh, yeah, a universal acclaim. Not like it is now, you know, where you can't please everyone. In those days, you could please everyone. Certainly the Porthcawl Gazette.
And at school then, you weren't, I mean, I would gather from your lack of paper certificates that you weren't necessarily applying yourself in other areas.
A dearth of paper certificates.
What did you get at school?
I was curiously detached. What did I get? Told off. I got two O-levels on my first go, yeah. Right, which is appalling, you know. And then I managed to ratchet that up to five. Because I had to have five to get a grant to go to drama school.
And your mum, who subsequently became the school teacher, how was she with that?
Well, here's the thing. They were always great. They were, I mean, they must have been concerned. No, I've spoken to mum and dad about this, and they always say, which is so sweet, I'm filling up now, Kirsty, that they always thought I had, you know, I had a talent.
And when you went on stage as a teenager, and it's particularly interesting, I think, for a teenage boy to do that, because, you know, teenage boys are not known for wanting to, expose themselves. You know what I'm saying?
They're sort of public
declarations of their intent. There you are, the young teenage boy. How did it feel when you were
out on
stage?
But you have to remember where I come from. I come from Port Talbot, and our heroes are Richard Burton and Anthony Hopkins. We had a wonderful, this is at Porthcawl Comprehensive now, where I went when I was about 14. The drama teacher there, Roger Burnell, is still a friend of mine now, and he just inspired you. He was so inspirational.
When you walked on stage then, can you recall the feeling?
Just felt like I was at home. You know, this is what I do. This feels right. It's because, you know, when I was in classes, I didn't really have a clue. I was detached. Just felt like this is where I should be.
Let's have some music then. We're on disc three now, Rob.
Well, Bruce Springsteen, who I adore, such a great artist. It's an obvious choice, but it would be very galvanising on a desert island, Born to Run.
Sprung from cages on highway, nine chrome wheel, fuel and checkered and stepping out over the line. Oh, maybe this town rips the bones from your back. It's a death trap. It's a suicide rap. We gotta get out while we're young. Cause tramps like
that was Bruce Springsteen and Born to Run. And you were saying, Rob Brydon, that there's something about that music, indeed in your, sort of, would it be your late teenage years, that connected with you.
There was something about blue-collar America. You know, I was living in Port Talbot. You know, it's a steel town, it's industrialised. But then when you go inland as well, away from the industry, there was something oddly, kind of almost like the Deep South in a way. It always used to remind me of the Dukes of Hazzard, you know, when we would drive down to West Wales and you'd be going through lanes and things. So I always gravitated towards American cultural influences.
Were you always very, very confident?
I got very, very bad acne as a teenager. I mean, you know, really bad. So that does affect your confidence. But in a sort of way, when it came to girls, I could always talk to them and be funny with them and make them laugh. but I never have the confidence to kind of move in for the kiss. Also, I didn't drink. You see, I didn't drink as a teenager. So
why not?
Do you know, I again, I get asked this and I don't know the answer. I didn't like the taste. I suppose it's got to be the first thing. So when boys would pass around, go, oh, have some of that, I'd go, ugh. As I think most kids do, but they get beyond that.
They especially get beyond it if they're lacking in a bit of confidence in the opposite sex.
I didn't equate the leap that it would make, that if I did have that social relaxant, it would help in my campaign towards meeting the opposite sex.
Right. So first girlfriend was when?
Well, not until I got to drama college.
Right.
Yeah. My family are very proud.
So is it true, Rob Brydon, that one of your relatives was a trapeze artist?
Well, you see, my dad was a salesman.
Yes, I was wondering about that.
So that, you see, that is, there's performance in that. Dad has always been funny, you know. But apparently there was a trapeze artist. Almost makes you want to do that programme, doesn't it, and actually find out for real. But
Well, you did do a programme that was similar. You did Rob Brydon's, was it, Identity Crisis, where you went back to Wales.
Yeah.
And you had, by all accounts, a sort of resistance to your Welshness, a slight aggression towards Welshness.
Yeah. And it was strange. It was odd. I'd lived out of Wales for about 20-odd years. I could only see the very... Oh, the sort of, oh, the negatives, oh, dear, dear, that sort of side. And I'd become very disenchanted.
I'm wondering if it was anything to do with the beginning of it. I mean, there you were, this very promising teenager who got all the lead parts and, as you say, very well received by the local press. Your parents laid off you in terms of any academic achievement because they knew that here they had a very talented boy who was going to make his life and maybe his fortune in entertainment. And then you got stuck in a little sort of cul-de-sac.
Yes.
Tell me what happened.
Well, I was at drama college, and in the second year of drama college, the BBC, Radio Wales, they got to know me and I would do voices for them. And then out of the blue, they offered me a radio show.
And this is whilst you're still at college?
Yeah.
Right.
So I left early and ended up doing about 6 years of radio and television in Wales, being a DJ. Then I was working on the shopping channel for Sky, so I was driving up and down to London. And when you're doing that, understandably, casting directors don't want to know, you know. I mean, I distinctly remember watching the British Comedy Awards in Cardiff and it appearing to be another planet. And I didn't see how I could ever possibly be a part of that.
Let's have some more. Well, it's not music now. Let me tell me about disc number four.
This is just one of my favourite sketches. Peter Cook and Dudley Moore, who I grew up loving. And this is a sketch that I'd have because it reminds me of my childhood. It was a big hit in our house. And my dad and I still use these phrases. You know, I can't talk now. He's here. I love you too.
The links go through to you direct via admin, not via us. Read the orange handbook, love. I appreciate your position, of course, but it's not really our pigeon. No, well, I'll get on to it for you and get back to you on blue, OK? No, I can't really talk because he's here. Yes, I love you too.
That was Peter Cook and Dudley Moore and Lance. And you say you and your dad still use phrases from that. Does your dad come and watch you do when you're doing stand-up and touring?
Yeah, he's my biggest fan.
Is he?
Yeah. To the point where other members of the family, you know, say, don't laugh quite so loudly, please. I can hear him. I can always hear him in the crowd.
So the drive that got you out of this little cul-de-sac that your career was in, did you have an agent and you had...
Yeah, but tiddly ones. I hope they don't mind me saying, you know, they didn't have any influence or anything, you know.
And at this period in your life, you would also be responsible for a family, would you? Did you have kids by that point?
Yes. First... child. Yeah, I was doing the odd little acting thing. I'm very bad in a Richard Gere film called First Night. I'm in the first 10 minutes of that playing First Villager. It's first everything.
You were also in, was it Lock, Stock and Two Smoking Barrels?
I was, yeah. And when it came out, I got mentioned in Empire magazine, which again, a bit like the Comedy Awards, it was another world. And I didn't think I'd ever be mentioned in there. And I can remember reading it and almost doing a little dance and saying, oh, wow. And thinking, well, I must be able to use this for some, you know, to further things. So what I did was I wrote about four characters. I made a video cassette using the money I was earning through voiceovers of these characters to send out. And the last character was Keith Barret. and that changed everything.
So that was Marion and Geoff. And, yes. And Keith Barret, for anybody who saw it at the time, it was a sparkling moment in television. It was the kind of show, it was just a little 10 minutes of this man who was driving a minicab, who was going through a very apparently painful divorce. We never saw any of the other cast of characters involved, and he was speaking to a fixed camera on the dashboard about his life. And it did the thing that brilliant comedy does, which is at one moment you were laughing with tears rolling down your face, and at the next moment you just had tears rolling down your face, because all human life was there in that cab. Had you written it?
Well, yeah, I wrote it with Hugo Blick. Now, Hugo had been at college with me. I used to carry it around with me, this VHS, a copy of it, in case I were to bump into someone of influence, you know. And I was at the BBC one day, because for a while I was the man who did, and with Match of the Day at 10, that Saturday night on BBC One, I used to do that. And I'd just been in there doing that, and I was walking through the corridors of TV Centre, which is a huge building, and I remember thinking to myself, oh, if I bumped into Hugo now, that would be good. And literally, as I thought that, he walked round the corner. And we went and had a drink, and I said, have a look at this. And he phoned, and he said, I've watched it, I love the last character, come in and let's talk. And that began what became Marion and Geoff.
Next piece of music.
Well, this is Bryn Terville. I'm sort of killing two birds with one stone here, because it's from Sweeney Todd, and I love Sondheim. If I ever did a musical, that's really what I'd like to do.
Would you like to do a musical?
I mean, not The Child Catcher and Chitty Bang Bang, but, you know, I'd like to do a decent one. And I went to see Bryn doing this in a concert performance at the Royal Festival Hall, and I took my eldest daughter, and I was on the edge of my seat. The man is just blessed with, number one, his voice, and charisma. And I was clapping so loudly, my daughter had to go, Dad, Dad, please, come on, please. Attracting attention.
Ah, pretty women, at their mirrors, how they make a man sing. Proof of heaven, as you're living, pretty women, yes, pretty women, here's to pretty women.
Bryn Terville singing Pretty Women from Sondheim's Sweeney Todd. So 2000 then, let's bring it a little more up to date, was when it all happened
for you. Yes,
because you stopped being the man with his nose pressed against the window of the British entertainment establishment and you actually went inside and started to enjoy it.
Yes.
Marion and Geoff, as we've said, was the thing that really got you noticed. And you developed a professional relationship with Steve Coogan because it was his company that produced Marion and Geoff.
And I was, you know, I can't overstate how much of a fan of Steve's I was and am.
I was going to pick you up.
Oh, no, and still am. I've just been working with him now. He's, you know, I love him.
It must have come, apart from the idea that you were going to fulfil yourself professionally and creatively, at a very personal level, just to be surrounded by people like you.
Very comfortable.
Yes.
It felt very, very comfortable.
And a huge relief.
Yes, all those things. I really can't overstate. It was a very, very tumultuous period. I started winning awards for two shows, for Marion and Geoff, but also for Human Remains.
Which was, well, to characterise it as dysfunctional couples wouldn't really even give people a glimpse.
Yeah.
So it was about, a very dark series of,
I can't remember
how many programmes.
Six of them. I did it with Julia Davis, and it's just as important in my story as Marion and Geoff was. It was happening at the same time.
To give people a glimpse of the sort of material it was, I mean, there are particularly a couple of swingers. Now, you might think, well, that's, you know, there we are. We've sort of seen that in comedy before. But the sting in the tail, and it is scorpion-like when it hits you, is that there's a sister living with them who's in a coma in the next room.
These are two characters called Gordon and Sheila. How we created that, and I'm quite proud of it, it was all through improvisation. And we're sat there, and I think I said, go, I mean, your sister now, she's been with us a long time, isn't she? And I think Julia said, 7 years, yeah, 7 years, yeah. And then I said, but she doesn't judge. She doesn't judge, does she? And then Julia said, no, that's the beauty of a coma. And we didn't know what it was going to be. So you imagine how exciting working like that is with someone who's on the same wavelength as you, you know.
And you say tumultuous. You say it was a tumultuous time. What can you tell me about the tumult?
Well, my first marriage, you know, ended. So it was a very, very, to refer you back to the word I used earlier and to lighten the moment with a humorous voice, Kirsty, a tumultuous time.
And thrown into such relief because at the same time you're fulfilling what
yeah,
you see.
Yeah, because on the one
be
hand you're being told you're wonderful,
yeah,
but you don't feel wonderful because you feel like you're failing. So, yeah, it was, yeah.
Let's have some more music then. What have we got?
Well, this is the theme music from Human Remains because it's so evocative of that time in my life. It's John Martin.
I don't want to know about evil. Only want to know about love. I don't want to know about evil. Only want to know about love. Sometimes it gets so hard to listen. Hard for me to use my eyes and all around the court.
That was John Martin and Don't Want to Know. I don't want to talk too much about Steve Coogan. You should never talk too much about Steve Coogan. But you have formed a very close bond. You were in A Cock and Bull Story, which was a Tristan Shandy movie. And you've just been filming again together.
I've just spent about a month with him filming again with Michael Winterbottom. It's for a TV series called The Trip, where we go around the Lake District reviewing restaurants, again playing versions of ourselves, and it's been possibly the most enjoyable thing I've ever done, you know, because we're improvising, firing off each other, hopefully raising each other's game, you know. And
yes, how much of it is competitive? I mean, I've heard you interviewed together where you get into this kind of competitive impersonation together.
Well,
and he judges your Al Pacino and you judge his.
Well, you know, you turn that on a bit. I mean, our real relationship is warmer. What you do is you take away the warmth. And we just, I think we both kind of delight in that.
But you know when, I mean, the programmes that we've spoken about in the early days of your television career, they did have, you know, a depth and a darkness and an edginess to them. Now, of course, when you move over to BBC One, there's every chance that the stairs light up as you walk down them. Are you quite comfortable with that?
As long as I can do the other stuff as well. I'm not as fussed about the work as some people are. I'm really not. I'm far more fussed about my family life than I am about the work, maybe because of being divorced and remarrying. That's far more important to me.
Does it sit heavily with you? I mean, you've mentioned it twice now. You say being divorced, it's present, is it?
Yeah, it's to some degree it's defining. You know, I'm very lucky. You know, we all get on very well, but still, it's part of who you are. It has a big effect on your life, you know, just logistically as much as anything else. When you've got kids at school age, mine go from 15 to 2, you know, you've got plenty to keep you occupied, and it's far more rewarding than anything you will ever do in your work, ever. Far more rewarding.
Let's have some music. What are we going to hear now?
Well, Paul Simon, who I just love. I love his humour. I saw a documentary about him once where he was driving around the district of New York that he grew up in, and he pointed to the house he grew up in and he said, my brother and I had rooms. That's my brother's room there next to my room, his room slightly smaller than mine, which is as it should be. And I love that kind of humour.
Slip sliding away. Slip sliding away. You know, the nearer your destination, the more you slip sliding away. And I know a woman became a wife. These are the very words she uses to describe her life.
Paul Simon and Slip Sliding Away. I'm hoping, Rob Brydon, that your teenage children at least are suitably embarrassed by your public profile, are they?
Yeah, they get more so. It's quite funny, isn't it? You go through a certain age and they're not at all, and then all of a sudden, oh, okay. They're embarrassed in a kind of knowing way, which I like.
So life on the island, I mean, at least, you know, you've mentioned Tom, who's just 2. At least on the island you will get a lie in.
Yes.
You get a proper night's sleep.
Yeah. Well, see, having children again after a gap, yeah, it's, you know, and he's not been a good sleeper. He's getting better.
And how, do you feel equipped? As you're not such an old dad, but you know, you're older.
Thank you, Kirsty. I'm 44.
Right. I have a friend who
people who are following at home.
I have a friend who said having children when you're a little bit older, very young children, is a little like going out to face Roger Federer on the centre court at Wimbledon with an old wooden tennis racket and long shorts. I mean, do you feel equipped for the job?
Oh, I see what they're saying. Yes. Very much so. Yeah, but I think my racket isn't quite the old wooden one. I just think it's not a very expensive titanium one, you know. Okay. I think you appreciate moments more because you're aware of how quickly they pass. Yes. When you're first having children, you don't realise that these times don't stick around. They're gone in the wink of an eye.
Will any of them be allowed to leave school with sort of just grazing two, well, they're not called O-levels now, but the equivalent?
That's a very good question. I would hope that they wouldn't, because I think that, you know, I'd like to have a bit more knowledge than I have. I went with my oldest daughter, we went to look at some sixth forms, and we're in one and we're in the history room and the history teacher was talking about the curriculum and everything, and I loved it. I thought it was fascinating. And I came out and I said, that was good, wasn't it? She said, well, yeah, it was fine, yeah. And I'm still thinking of just paying him to come and give me history lessons at home, just so I can have a bit more knowledge. Because if Henry VIII comes up, I'll just do Ray Winston being Henry VIII.
It's not the full picture, that, I don't think.
It's, well, it's part of the picture, Kirsty.
Let's have your final disc. What is it?
I love James Taylor. You see, James Taylor, Paul Simon, I love what they do with their lyrics. And this song, it just really resonates with me about acting, the business, and about life. It's called That's Why I'm Here.
Person to person and man to man, I'm back in touch with my long-lost friend. Listen to reason and understand, and think of me from way back when. You said me and Melissa, well, we fell out of love, ran out of luck, seems like the lightning struck. I've been thinking of leaving.
James Taylor, and That's Why I'm Here. So, Rob, the Bible and the complete works of Shakespeare and your book to take to this island.
Well, I would take Complete Dylan Thomas because it would remind me of Wales. I would enjoy that. So that'd be everything he wrote, you know, his poems, plays, you know, short stories.
The collected
stories.
Works, it's yours. And a luxury too.
Well, I love music, you see. And if I wasn't doing this, I'd love to be a musician. So I would take an eternally tuned guitar and I would learn to play it. I'd line coconuts up on the beach to represent an audience and play to them.
It's a slightly sad image, but
well,
yes.
Well, you know, I'm going to be on a desert island, Kirsty. What do you expect?
I'll give you the guitar. And one of the eight. If you had to save one of these eight discs from the waves, which one would it be?
Maybe... Born to Run, because it would be uplifting. It would be loud. And I think that would be important. You'd have plenty of time for quiet introspection. I want a good sound system, though. You haven't mentioned the sound system.
It'll be of the very best.
State of the art.
No, actually, I think it's an old wind-up gramophone player, but anyway.
Oh, dear.
Rob Brydon, thank you very much for letting us hear your Desert Island discs.
Thank you.
You've been listening to a download from the BBC. You'll find more information on the Radio 4 website, bbc.co.uk/radio4.